The importance of relationship building inside of business is something I overlooked in the beginning. Now, though, I see how powerful fostering connections and building a network of very aligned and congruent people can actually be inside business. And today we're diving in how to do it in a way that feels good for you. Heya, I'm Amanda, and welcome to the Best Damn Coach podcast, where I will teach you how to coach yourself, how to coach your clients, and how to run your coaching business. The number one goal of this show, though, is to help you be the best damn coach you can be so your clients go out and tell the world about you. So let's do the damn thing. Hello, and welcome to this week's episode of the BDC podcast. I'm grateful, as always, that you are so here. I'm grateful that you have been along on this journey for all of 2022, which for me specifically took so many, you know, twists and turns that I didn't ever expect. And it just goes to show you how much progress can happen in a year. And I'm really feeling that right now. And I think it's also organic that as we wind down the last few weeks of 2022, we're just automatically thinking about, like, what does 2023 hold? As the year winds down, it's a time of year where I really like to invite those of you that are ready to go all in on your business. You're ready to take your business to the next level. You have a vision. You're not sure how to get started, where to get started. You're knowing that maybe you don't have the clients you want. You're struggling maybe with confidence. Those imposter thoughts might be creeping in. You just know that whether it's business or life, there is something calling you to the next level. This is where I open the door to my one-to-one clients that are ready to just say yes and start the year off with energy and fire towards that next level, whatever that is for them. So I have opened up spots for one-to-one coaching with me. If you are interested in that, I would love to have a conversation with you to make sure we are a great fit for one another, that I feel confident about the direction that I can support you to go in. So if that is something you would love to chat about, you can head on over to my calendar link, which is amanda-walker.com/letschat, LETSCHAT. You'll get a direct link to my calendar. We can chat and talk about what is next for you in 2023. Welcome to the Best Damn Coach podcast. Today, I'm very excited about our upcoming conversation all about relationships and relationship building in business, which is something that I've learned the hard way, honestly, in business a little bit. So please welcome to the show, Michael Roderick. I'm so glad you're here. So thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me. I'm excited to be here.
So let's take a little back step. We were introduced in a colleague, Selena Sue's event, which she is an amazing example of relationship building and connection. And I was grateful to connect with you. We missed each other very slightly live and in the flesh, but I was excited to have a great conversation around coaching on your show. But I would love to know more about just you and what's led you to this moment in time where you're at in your life.
Sure. So I started out as a high school English teacher, and I went from being a high school English teacher to becoming a Broadway producer in under 2 years. So a lot of people were very curious as to how, and I got my master's in educational theater at NYU. And one of the things I had learned about was the power of simulations. So I started hosting workshops where I would simulate one-on-one meetings, job interviews, and other networking experiences. And I started to notice a lot of patterns in terms of how people interacted. And from those patterns, I started to develop frameworks and build out frameworks. And eventually I got to the point where everybody was asking me, how do you develop these frameworks? How do you make yourself referable? So I started developing frameworks around referability and helping people figure out how to make themselves more referable, how to get their ideas out there. And that is the work I do today.
So cool. And I want to talk about your freebie because that kind of coincides with that word referability. But before we go on, I'm curious, like, can you share a little bit about some of the patterns you were seeing that kind of led to the frameworks you built out?
Sure. So I started to notice that there were a lot of challenges that people had around asking. Over and over and over again, whenever I would have conversations with people who had something that they needed or had something that they were looking for, the thing that they were always really struggling with was the asking piece of it. How do I ask? And over time, what I noticed was that most people have only ever been taught one way to ask. We were only sort of given the kind of direct way. And we see this a lot where basically, like, you'll see people say things like, if you don't ask, you don't get, just ask for it, just go for it. And the problem with a lot of that advice is that it basically pushes you to make a direct ask, where you're going to somebody and you're being very direct and you're saying, give me this thing, help me with this thing, do this thing for me. And what that does is that actually triggers the fight or flight response in the brain. And I'm sure you've probably had this experience.
Totally. You're like, I'm out of here. This doesn't feel good. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Where you're just like, you know, it's like we're in the wild and it's like, I'm trying to steal your food. So I'm feeling anxiety, right? Because I'm asking you for this thing. You're feeling anxiety because you don't expect to be asked, right? Especially if we're like first meeting each other. Like, that just feels weird and awkward. But as I saw, people were just always seeing this is the only way. So I started to ask myself, okay, well, what are other ways that we could think about asking? And when I started to notice how people who had been very successful operated and thought about asking, I noticed that there were actually different ways than direct. And the way I broke it down was I spell the word dime. So there's four ways to think about asking, easy to remember because it spells the word dime. The first is direct, which we just talked about. But the second, which is probably one of the more powerful ones, is the indirect. And in an indirect ask, I don't ask you directly for the thing. I make you a thought partner in helping me solve the problem. So I don't ask you for money. I don't ask you to find investors for the Broadway show. I say, my goal right now is to try and find a group of investors who are going to get involved in this particular show. And I want to see that show succeed. Do you have any ideas? You're savvy. You've met a lot of different types of people. Do you have any thoughts as to, like, what might I do to make this happen? And the interesting thing about that is the brain leaves this level of fight or flight and has to go up to the level of reasoning. We have to take that time to reason and sort of think creatively. And as a result, you're either going to give me really great advice as to who I should reach out to, or you're going to make an introduction. You're going to find whatever shortcut is going to help you solve the problem because you're now a thought partner, right? Like, you're now helping me with this process.
You're invested.
Exactly. And then as I started to kind of see just different ways people interacted, I encountered what I call the mutually beneficial. And people who are very good at asking in a mutually beneficial way really take the time to understand what it is that you need and what it is that they need. And they really paint this very, very attractive picture, right? So let's just say, for example, I was trying to get somebody to sponsor a conference or an event. The direct way would be like, hey, you know, here's my deck. You know, do you want to sponsor this? And the indirect way might be to say, like, hey, you know, do you know anybody who might want to sponsor? But the mutually beneficial way is for me to come to you and say, in our past conversations, you told me that your ideal client fits this particular category. And I'm hosting a conference with people who fit into that exact category. They are the ideal client for you. I'm expecting probably about 500 of those people to come. Now, in the past, you've told me that the lifetime value of those people for you is $50,000. Right now, I'm putting together a sponsorship opportunity where you would be able to do a presentation on a panel and also have a booth outside of the conference itself, as well as get a permission-based list of the people who are interested in your service. And the sponsorship opportunity right now is $5,000. What have I done?
Yeah, you've made it work for both of us.
Exactly.
You haven't gotten to the E yet, but already, like, the M is always what feels really fantastic for me in business, is when I know it's mutually beneficial and we can hold space for each other's success simultaneously.
Yeah, exactly. And the E is the most interesting, in my opinion, because it's the ask that we ask ourselves. It's not how we interact with people. It's the ask that we ask ourselves. And that's the extraordinary ask. So in the extraordinary ask, we challenge our assumptions about what we could reach out for. So most people will read a book or listen to a podcast and they'll think, wow, that person's amazing. I wish I could reach out to them. I wish I could, you know, contact them. And then they will literally not do anything, right? Like they will just sit there and never do the outreach, never go for that like big ask or anything of that nature. But the people who do, the people who take that big shot, tend to do better. And most of the people who are reaching out to somebody at a significantly higher level than them, at a significantly higher level of influence, they're directly asking that person for their support. They're not thinking about indirect and they're not thinking about mutually beneficial. They're literally reaching out to that person to say, can I be on your podcast? Can I have this opportunity? Can you do this thing for me? So when you're the person who goes to that person and you come with something that is indirect that gives them kind of like a curiosity thing and they want to become a thought partner with you, or you give them something mutually beneficial, to them, it feels so different than all of the outreach that these other people are doing to them. And you're way more likely to get a response.
Yeah. Oh, this really good nuggets in here that I want to hit on. Our coaches are service providers in some capacity, and many of which want to be well known in their sphere of influence, right? In their sphere of coaching. And you and I both get this, I'm sure, as podcast hosts. There is the drippy, sneaky, hey, just listen to your episode. It was so good. I loved the part where, and especially because, you know, before this, our podcast was Feel Amazing Naked. We really found that majority of female influence was listening. And so when it was, you know, it was just, it felt like they were trying to force authenticity and mutualism, which there wasn't any of that. However, I do find that there are opportunities that I feel like even at audiences, you know, comparable at the same level. So how do we do that in a way that's mutually beneficial and still says, hey, I want to get my info out into the world?
Yeah. Well, I think it's really the aspect of doing a good amount of research and understanding what does the other person actually value, right? And really taking the time. So if you've got a podcast host that you've wanted to reach out to, have you listened to them on other people's shows? Like, do you know anything about what is of value to them or what's exciting to them or what types of things they're interested in? Because that's how you can come to the table with an idea of something that's mutually beneficial. So if somebody on a podcast is talking about a charity that they support and that they believe in, and you are also a fan of that charity, and this ties to what you were saying before, it can't be, oh, well, I'm going to say I'm a fan of that charity, right? Or I believe in that cause. It's got to match. It's got to be like, I actually do believe in that cause as well, or I'm excited about that idea as well. And then you just go to that person and you say, I listened to you on this show. I know that you had mentioned this. I had an idea for how we might be able to collaborate, do something together and support this charity or and support this goal. Or I had an idea and I would love to just hear if you think it makes sense. And it's totally fine if it doesn't. But let me know if you'd like to talk a little bit more about it. And the thing is, if you create that level of curiosity, it's really hard for people to not think about, well, what is that thing that they want to do? You know, if somebody reaches out to me and they tell me everything, I have no reason to reach back out to them because I can just say yes or no immediately. But if somebody reaches out to me and says, I've got this idea for you, I've got this thing that I'd like to, you know, talk through, then now it's like in my head and I'm really curious. I'm like, well, what are they thinking? And like, what might it look like? And how could that be? So I'm more likely to reach back out.
Yeah, that's such a great reflection for me even to think about. But when I hear you speaking, what I'm hearing is really this idea of relationship fostering is a long game strategy, right? It's a long game. We're not here for a quarter of play. And I think when I get bombarded with agencies trying to pitch other people's podcasts, for me, it's that quick fix. I wish I want to be on the show now instead of nurturing that relationship. For me, it's an automatic turnoff. And so that's why I truthfully haven't, you know, done a lot of opportunities have been because I've interacted with people, been connected with people, right? And there is that long game strategy.
Yeah.
Can we talk just more about relationships and why for you, in addition to seeing these patterns, but why do you feel that fostering these relationships has benefited you, not just in your business life, but I'm sure in your personal life as well? What's the fruit of this work?
Yeah, I mean, the thing I often say about this is that the keys to all the doors we need open are in other people's pockets. There are people who they've been through whatever you're struggling with right now, and they've already gotten past it. So your roadblock is their rubble. And those people, there's so much you can learn from them. There's so many opportunities that can happen. And there's so much that can happen as a result of knowing somebody who either has had experience that you haven't had or is connected to larger platforms, larger opportunities, all of those different types of things. It's just sort of like expands your horizons. So the more that you take the time to diversify the network that you have, and the more that you take the time to really get to know people and build relationships with those people, not only can they support you in the things that you're doing, but you get to know them so well that now you don't see the world just through your eyes. You start to see the world through their eyes. So if I get to know somebody for a while and I get to know like what they're excited about and what they love and what they, you know, I may be out and notice something and say, oh man, I should reach out to Amanda and basically say, like, let her know about this thing. And it's like those types of things will come to you and it creates this flow. And I think that the thing that people make mistakes about when it comes to relationship building is they don't pay attention to the flow. They're either in a state where they're just giving all the time and they're never asking for anything, or they're in the state where they're asking all the time and they're never giving anything. And in both situations, they're complaining, right? Because we all know somebody who suffers from, right? Yeah. We all know somebody who suffers from what I call the giver's fix, where every time you give and you support somebody else, you get a rush of chemicals in the body. Some say it's oxytocin, some say it's dopamine, but regardless, you get a rush whenever you give. But just like an addict, you can get hooked on that rush and never let people know what it is that you actually need and what it is that you're looking for. And unfortunately, you educate your audience to believe that you have no needs, because how could you possibly have anything you need if you're always giving all the time?
Yeah, I mean, even go beyond like professional world, this is to me like the struggle and the exhausted motherhood culture that we live in, because it's better to give than receive, right? If we grew up hearing that. And so here we are just giving, 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 giving. And the same with our children. There comes a point where it feels good to take care of your kids. And at some point you just freaking tap out though, right? You need to feel something in return.
Yes, exactly. And that's the thing. It's that aspect of balance, right? The way that I think about it is I refer to it as the gate strategy. Every day, if you open and close the gate, I promise you, you will create flow within your network. And here's how it works. Every day, you make it a point to give without expectation of return. And that's really important. A gift is not a gift if there is expectation of return. If there's expectation of return, it's not a gift. It's a transaction. Right?
Yes.
Every day, you also ask for what you truly need. You make sure that you are letting people outside of your circle within your network know what it is you could use help with, what it is you could use support with. And feel free to use Dime if you're feeling anxious about making that ask every day. Right? You can make an indirect ask. You can make a mutually beneficial ask, right? You can reach out to people and say, I could use help or support. And the thing that I often like to say about that specifically is that you limit the things you get in life when you limit other people's creativity.
Tell me more. Yeah, what do you mean? Like an example.
So basically, if I say to you, will you introduce me to this person? And I give you a name. For you, it's a yes or a no, because there's no creative thought involved. But if I say, you know, I'm really interested in getting this idea onto larger platforms. And I'm curious if you have any thoughts as to who would be the type of person who would like to hear this kind of message on their platform. Well, now your brain isn't in yes or no, right? Like your brain is in that creative space, and you may come up with a way better introduction than if I asked you directly for whoever that sort of high level podcaster or contact was, right? because you're using your creativity. So that is how it works.
Yeah, sure.
The T is for thank. And we very, very rarely take the time to go back through our network and ask ourselves, who hasn't been thanked appropriately for what they've done for me and how much they've helped? So if every day you're basically like, let me, you know, think of somebody that I could thank and reach out to that person and let them know what you did for them and what it, you know, what they did for you and what it meant, it's so, so powerful. And then the E is for experiment. And if every day you just ask yourself, what is something I haven't tried yet? And you test something out, especially on the relationship building side, right? Like if you're just like, okay, I always meet people at a coffee shop. I'm going to try to do a meeting this time walking around the block with somebody. I'm just going to see if I like it. I'm just going to see if they like it. You know, you're going to start to discover things that are working and things that are not. And patterns are always the precursor to frameworks. So if every day you're opening and closing the gate, you're going to stop to be able to optimize how you're giving. You're going to stop to be able to optimize how you're asking, how you're thinking, and coming up with all sorts of interesting and new experiments. And over time, you're going to start to figure out what is best practice for you and really develop a relationship with your network that has that level of flow.
So amazing. Okay, so you're blowing my mind a little bit. I'm going to tell you why in just a second. But I'm curious from a strategy or a workflow perspective, like how do you integrate this time into your week? Do you carve out like an hour every day? It's just relationship work. I'm curious what that looks like from a high level, you know, detail down view.
Yeah, I think it's different for everybody, right? And you think about it in the model that's going to work best for you. So a lot of the time I break my day into conversations with, you know, just people I want to catch up with, people I want to get to know, work that I do for clients, and presentations or sort of opportunities to sort of share. And at the end of those experiences, I ask myself, well, which of those things did I hit on? You know, in that scenario. So I look back and I say, okay, well, I just did that presentation and that was a pretty nice give. I like really did share some solid information. And I think like that fits into sort of the quota of that give, right? And maybe I'm doing a presentation and somebody is asking me to share some kind of offer or share some kind of like set up a call kind of, you know, scenario. So that may also in that moment count as my ask, right? Like that may be the thing that ends up being, but there may also be instances where I literally just do a presentation or I do a AMA or something of that nature. And it's like, okay, chalk that off as a give. Right. And then it may be I'm having a conversation with somebody and maybe I haven't chatted with them in a while. And I just open that conversation with, you know what? I haven't done my thank you today. I'm just going to open this conversation with telling them, you know, I just wanted to say thank you first. I wanted to just say thank you first for all that you've done. You've been really great about helping me as I've navigated some of these other challenges in my life. And I just really appreciate you taking that time and really thinking about that. And maybe I just open that conversation with that. And then who knows sort of where it goes or what happens next. And then I'm always looking back and saying, okay, what are the experiments that I could try? Like, what are the things I haven't done yet? What's something I haven't really tested or tried out? I literally just a couple weeks ago started doing daily videos on LinkedIn that I call mic drops.
So punny.
Yeah, you know, I'm a dad, right? So like it's a fun, you know, exactly. And I started doing those and it was just an experiment. It was like, okay, well, let's see. And then I had a lot of people say that they really got something out of it and it was fun. So I've kept doing it. And that's the thing. As I go through the day, I'm always kind of looking at, okay, well, which boxes does this tick? And then when I close the gate at the end of the day, when I really kind of look at cumulatively, what did I do? I can start to notice, oh, well, you know, when I do these presentations for this particular group, I do get a lot of opportunities out of it. A lot of things happen. When I do these presentations, I don't really hear from anybody and nothing really happens. So do I want to, you know, keep doing those presentations, or do I want to focus in that other area? And then I can ask myself that question of where do I want to focus my time? Where do I want to focus my attention and my energy?
Yeah. So this whole conversation is so interesting for me because relationship building in business is something that I struggled with and still kind of do. But one of the reasons is, you know, I came from a world where I was so in the box on going through the motions step by step and never really took time to like step outside to see the influence of the people I was reaching. And then thrust into business, I was so bogged down by the day in and day out of fast growth. How do I handle this? That I kind of had this mindset of like, well, I can do this alone. Like I don't need a network. Or if I thought, you know, I was getting maybe some advice from outsiders that were really coming from a place of ask, 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 no matter how you sugarcoat it, it still doesn't feel fantastic for either party involved. Until the shift came for me inside of really realizing that I wasn't even honestly focused on the reciprocity. I was just focused on the service. Like, how can I serve other humans, not clients, but just people? Like, how can I support other people? Because that's what I personally needed to get into a place where then I could open, like you said, the gate, really, like both directions were existent. And so now I've started to connect with so many cool people. It's one of the reasons I started the podcast was I really felt that I was working on relationship building specifically with females at the time. And it has honestly paid dividends, not only to my business, sure, but to the confidence and to the element of just meeting really cool people that I feel like otherwise you would have never had the opportunity to connect with in life.
Yeah. And the thing is, when you start to have those conversations, you start to notice there's so much more to these people. And I think that a lot of time what tends to happen is we get into these environments, especially like networking education is very, very bad. And it causes a lot of issues. And it actually, you know, causes a lot of challenges with people when it comes to actual relationship building, because most networking education frames everything around the idea of that reciprocity. Right. So it's almost always kind of framing it as like, okay, I'm going to meet you and we're going to have a business meeting and we're going to talk about like, well, what do you need and what do I need? And we're going to do this like back and forth sort of transactional thing. And we're not going to build a relationship that way. Right. Because we're literally just, you know, trading commodities at that point. But when you do something like a podcast, when you do something like just have a conversation with somebody about their expertise, you're not in that mode, right? You're just in a conversational mode. So then you start to realize like, I really liked talking to this person, or I really got along with them, or I really thought that what they had to say was really useful and really helpful. And it changes that dynamic, right? Like it just changes that side of things. And I think that the danger is thinking that networking and relationship building and all of these things is about reciprocity. When it's really not. Reciprocity has so many variables to it. There are two elements of reciprocity that I think most people forget about. And that is the fact that everybody has a reciprocity impulse and everybody has a reciprocity timeline. So if you have a reciprocity impulse and it's a strong reciprocity impulse, if somebody gives you something, it's like a hot potato. You're like, I need to give you something back right away. Like, and if you have a very strong reciprocity impulse, that's what you're going to do. Somebody does something for you, you want to do something for them right away because you just can't handle that feeling of receiving. But if you have a low reciprocity impulse, you'll get something and be like, okay, great, thanks. What else you got? Right? Yeah. And it's not that you're a bad person. I think that there's demonizing of people who receive and don't give something in return.
I agree with that. Sure.
Right? Like it's and the thing is, all of us have moments in our lives where we are really just in a place where we need to receive. We can't really give at that moment. There are things going on in our lives. There are things that don't really make sense. Like sometimes we just are not going to follow that particular model, even if we have a strong reciprocity impulse. But the other aspect is this reciprocity timeline. And if you've been burned before, where somebody gave you something and then came back and asked you for something ridiculous, and you were like, oh man, I gotta be very careful about, you know, giving and doing something. Like, you're actually going to spend more time vetting people. So you actually have a much longer reciprocity timeline where you're going to vet somebody before you do something for them, before you give back, before you make any of that happen, because
that's
you were
me.
Burned, right?
That's me. Yeah, totally.
Well, that's the thing.
Yeah.
I mean, let's face it, right? Like, coaching, consulting, like that world, there are a lot of people who basically live off of this reciprocity idea, and it's super imbalanced where they're like, I'm going to make this intro for you. And for that intro, I want to be, you know, in front of your 50,000, 100,000 person mailing list. But this intro is only on the hook if you give me that. Like, and when you've had that experience, you're like, I'm afraid of anybody who's saying that they want to do something for me because I think that you want something in return.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And then you feel misguided around it. So the walls come up and you put up the barriers and you're afraid to lean in, right? And I mean, that's just life in general, but I very much see that play out in business for sure.
Yeah, all the time.
This is such an important conversation to have. I'm like, oh, you need to come into my BDC and talk about this and relationships in general, because it would be so powerful for the community to hear too. But you did something that I just want to really say thank you for. When I was on your show after we were done recording, I don't remember exactly how you phrased it, but one of the things you said to me is, hey, who can I keep in mind to connect you with, or, you know, something of that nature. I just want to tell you, it left such an impact on me that I've taken that with me now into recordings. It was super impactful for me because it felt really good being on that side of like, oh, he's got me in his mind now. And I want to have all of these people that I get to interact with in my mind too, because we are not all zones of, you know, our zone of genius is small and we have all this wealth of information around us to be able to make these super amazing connections. So I just want to say thank you because it definitely influenced me and has helped me shift my mindset around more relationships as well.
So glad to hear that. Yeah, it's one of those things where if you're having a conversation with somebody, you're getting to know them. It takes less than a minute to hear from them where their focus is. And it takes you very little time to just jot down some notes about, okay, what is something I can kind of keep an eye out for? And the thing is, if you jot that down, you're likely going to start seeing those opportunities. Whereas if you don't ask about it, you're not going to think about that. It's not going to come into your head. So I often find it's that aspect of being intentional, you know, about that process that really helps you to be able to see where the opportunities are for others and what you can do to be helpful.
Yeah, agreed. Totally. Well, thank you so much for today. I would love for you to share more about where our audience can connect with you. And I would love for you to share to the referability rater that you have as a resource.
Yeah. So folks can just go to smallpondenterprises.com. That's the website. You're welcome to go there and check that out, join the mailing list, all that fun stuff. And then the referability rater is at myreferabilityrater.com. And this is a tool that you can use to basically, you answer a series of questions and it looks at three main principles of referability and it gives you a rating based on that. So it'll tell you sort of how likely it is that you are referable right now. So you can really kind of see like, where are you strong? Where are you weak? And get a better sense of sort of how that's working for you.
Okay, cool. Super cool. I'm excited to try that resource myself. So again, thank you so much for joining us. I'm grateful for your zone of genius for sure. And I can't wait for this episode to go live so we can start thinking of all the relationship connections to make.
I love it. Thank you again so much for having me. It was an absolute blast.
Every week, I put my heart and soul into this podcast to bring you value and to help you grow as a person and as a coach. And one of the ways, it's very simple ways you can return that favor is by leaving us a review. So if you haven't left us a review, head on over to Apple or Spotify, leave us a review, let us know how we're doing, let us know what content you love and which content pieces are really speaking to you now.